Captain.
Mr. Higdon, I want to introduce you to somebody, Congressman Mark Walker, from the 6th District of North Carolina. And that's Congressman Walker right here.
Absolutely.
Do you take a load off there? How are you today?
I'm doing well, folks. I didn't see that step up.
You're fine. I thought it was a little early to have a little gin and tonic, but other than that, you're okay. So,
just giving a doctor's prep.
Fair enough. It saved me. I'm a former Baptist minister. That's exactly right. So, well, today is a special day, and it's a day, Mr. Higdon, that we're set aside to honor you. In fact, last week, on September the 19th, there was a flag flown over the United States Capitol in your honor, and today I would like to present that certificate and the flag that was flown over the United States Capitol here. In fact, there's the certificate of authenticity, and it says, as the request of our staff or our congressional office, this flag was flown in deepest gratitude to Staff Sergeant William L. Higdon for your service to the United States of America and the United States Army during your time as a combat engineer in Germany during World War II. Here's the flag here, and I'd like to put this to you. There's the actual flag, all right? Here you go. I'm going to set it right over here and ask you a few questions, if that's okay. Is that all right? When politics, they say they didn't say something anyway, whether they know the answer or not. Now, I was doing a little reading on your history here. Originally from Louisville, Kentucky, is that correct?
That's right.
And about 1551, you brought the family over from Louisville, Kentucky here to Reidsville.
Right.
So 1551, usually that's middle age for most people. For you, that was just getting started, obviously. That was 46 years ago. And brought some of the family over here, and you worked for American Tobacco for a little while?
Yes, sir.
Retired from there?
Yes, sir.
Well, that's quite a distinguished career. Take me back to World War II, if you would, a little bit. And you remember your service time there, going in the United States Army?
Yes, sir.
What made you sign up or think about going in the Army back then?
Oh, Sam.
Uncle Sam? Gave you a little call?
Yes. Yes. Gave him a little card.
Right.
Appreciate
it, but still wrong. A little encouragement, wasn't there? And you spent time, was it, in England and France and Germany?
Right.
Anything that stands out in those three countries, if you think back and remember what some of the things that you were involved with?
No, but I had a lot of good times in French Paris going into MCO, for soldiers to go with them.
Yes.
And get coffee and donuts. If they didn't have a place to stay, you could find a chair and stay in there.
Right. But yeah.
It was a nice journey. And I always had a good time. And they had a big nice dance hall that had one of the big finest bands in the country.
Right, really? Yeah.
And a lot of girls would come in and dance, you know, and people would dance and they'd break one of them, you know.
Right.
Yeah, well, always trying to get the first one.
Sure. Yeah.
I got one and they got good. I couldn't keep the good.
Tap me on your shoulder. I
sent some line up around my wall. So I decided I wanted to dance, but I love to dance.
Yeah.
So I decided I was going to get over and get me one. I finally got the ugliest one out. And it worked.
Get your dance. Nobody
followed me then, you know.
It's amazing. Got just all the different stories and over the history, and what an important job that you had, literally, with some of the mines, during the mines work, and paving the way for some of the things for soldiers over there. So you had some important work there, didn't you, in World War II?
Yeah, we landed in London, right. In Liverpool,
uh-huh.
And we were stationed right in London for 3 months, so we was tearing up these buildings, and tearing someone with these bombs. See, at that time, Germany was sending over those V-2s. They were dropping right in London on us.
Give me a year. Was that 42, 43? What time was that?
I think it was 43.
43, okay. All right.
Yeah. And we do all the way to the cars to go. Then we moved into Germany after that. And all in France and all down the line.
74 years ago almost.
Yeah. We build these floating bridges for all these places where they couldn't sit down and look any other way. And stuff like that's business.
Sure. Well, what do you think about all your family coming out here today on this special occasion?
I was really surprised.
Are they sneaky like this all the time? Because they sneak up past you?
Yeah.
Yeah. Met some of your sons there, your daughter?
Yeah.
In-laws?
Three wonderful daughters, of course. So, just quite filled in. Three of them.
Do you think about what it meant to kind of really change the course of our country's future, that to your family, my family, would have an opportunity, the freedoms that we existed, the role that you guys played, and the 400 plus thousand that perished to give their lives to be able to make that kind of difference? Do you think about the job that you did in that group that's called the Greatest Generation? You ever think about that?
Yeah, I think about that all the time.
Yeah.
I was telling Denise there a while ago, I believe, sitting over in Mark's office.
He also helped build the Alcat in Iowa.
I can see those guys in America. Yeah. But all the rest of us, some of them all the time. Yeah, they were wonderful people. I was telling them about some of the Spanish people, most of them were Spanish.
Yes, sir.
Picked them up when I came from California, so we're going there too. And then we sent them overseas. Then I went into Georgia on another outfit. Didn't just send us all over.
Yeah.
But a lot of them was Spanish people, some of the best people that ever worked with.
How about that? You got a couple grandsons over here. I'm sure they're pretty proud of your history. Not everybody has a hero like they do that's in the family tree. So you ever think about the next generation and your grandkids and all that's coming after you?
Yeah, I've said that a few times. I don't think I've had a disease as we did. I get choked up thinking about it.
Yeah. Well, I will tell you this. It's my honor to be up here with you, Mr. Higdon, and we thank you for your service. It's a small token of our appreciation of all the different things paving the way for many different generations of future to come. We want to say congratulations for the great work, for the great service. You're a hero, and frankly, we're quite impressed that you're moving around, recall, and everything else. 97, I heard your driver's license doesn't expire till you're 101. Is that a secret? We're supposed to share that part?
I don't have it with me.
Well, how do we know I'm giving this to the right
guy? Yeah, Billy asked me and said, you want to take a bill pole?
Well, once again, God bless you. It's a privilege that you get a chance to know you. It certainly is today. How about a round of applause?
Thank you, everybody, and everybody coming out with taking. So it's special. So, you got anything you want to say?
I just want to say thank all of you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Daddy.
Thank you,
Daddy.
You're while we're here.
Yeah.
You're while we're here. Thank you.
Yeah.
It's amazing his generation. They don't look for accolades.
They don't.
And
they don't
a lot of them never even talked a lot about it. They just came back transitioning.
You got two things in life to do. You got two things. You can make it easy for yourself. I'll tell all the guys that goes into service, you got two choices. You can make it easy or you can make it rough on yourself. You got the choice yourself. So I take the high road. Same way it was life out here. It's a big world. You have a lot of choices to take.
A lot of wisdom there. How about still getting his uniform?
That's
impressive.
My brother did that.
Billy.
Yeah, I went and took his blouse. It's a little bit small, but he got off and put his shirt and his trousers together.
That's very cool.
Campaign cover.
Yeah.
Everybody's original.
Nice and crisp. Not even wrinkled. I'm looking for that. Look sharp.
Yeah.
No mothballs.
No mothballs. Over here in the back, didn't you, Mr. Eagle?
Yeah. I got another birthday, and I'm working hard to get there.
Is it Christmas Eve? Is that correct?
Yeah.
pretty special. Of course, you probably got probably didn't get double presents back then, did you? You just got one for both Christmas Eve and Christmas birthday?
Back then, yeah.
It's just luck of the draw being born on Christmas Eve.
I got a great family.
Dad took me down. He was in Louisville a couple of years ago. We went down to his old place. And he showed me around with his grandfather's farm.
Yes.
And the different people with his relations. And I looked around and I said, Daddy, how'd y'all get down? Nice paved roads then. You know, there. I said, Daddy, how'd y'all get around down here then? He said, we stayed in the ruts.
there's a little wisdom in that.
We stayed in the ruts.
This is pretty special, absolutely.
You were talking about his uniform.
Yes.
You informed me in his Mark's office that you and I tore up one of his hats he used to wear.
Yeah, he isn't forgetting that.
Oh, yes, about that.
Do you remember that one?
I've been real lucky. Blessed. Great man.
What island was that feeling?
One in Alaska.
Or an island in Alaska. Alaska.
And he used to have fire watches at night, literally a fire watch inside the old tin top.
Right.
He had a little stove in there. He had to keep the thing burning all night. And it'd still be ice inside the tents in the morning, of that. Be ice inside your wall tents there in Alaska. Yeah. There would be ice inside your tents in Alaska.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's been 13 months in Alaska. I lived there. There it was. Yeah. You could turn it moss and stuff up. Mosquitoes would come out in swarms, and we had more deaths, you know.
Right.
And they'd never be dead. Because at nighttime, I had a cross in each of them. You tuck it up, you don't have mosquitoes on the bottom.
Everything up there with wood hydraulic was all push and pull,
over
cables.
Yeah.
Everything was called cables then.
Cut to the wilderness, basically.
And through the corduroy roads up there, log road, and just push out.
How long did he serve actually in the Army? How long did he get out after World War II? Or?
Yeah, right after. Okay. He discharged on the 4th of December 1945.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, you served 3 years now. 10 months, is that what you said?
Yes, sir.
Almost 4 years.
Yeah. Yeah, right in the heart of the war. Still hard to wrap your mind around. 73 years ago, 74 years ago, but from here.
The technology is just quantum leaps.
Yeah, 3/4 of a century.
I think I've always said that any young man who can make something out of yourself, he can pull it. Should join the army 2 years, I think. I think makes a better man out of his own job. Treat the man next to you. Mm-hmm. Respect the man.
You gotta learn to work with people.
Be good for him. Yeah.
Evidently, it was good and paid off for you. So, well, thanks again for letting me come out today. It's been an honor to be able to visit with you, Mr. Higdon. It certainly has. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.